discuss on the topic retaining wall, and I'll be helping you with the solved problems given in the textbook named Design of Reinforced Concrete Structure, and the author is N. Krishna Raju, and the third edition. Well, you might be knowing about walls, but what is retaining wall? So retaining walls, if you divide the word into two parts, retaining, so something which is retaining, the wall which is retaining the soil from the collapse is called retaining wall. This retaining wall are used to retain earth fill or any other material so that ground surface at different elevations are maintained on either side of the retaining wall. And this picture will give you how the retaining wall will be looking like. There are two portions of the retaining wall. The one portion is a vertical part which is called a stem, and the horizontal portion is called slab or base slab, and the front portion is called toe slab, and the rear portion is called heel slab. And the different types of retaining wall are classified into four types, and the first one is called gravity wall, the second one is called piling wall, third one is called cantilever wall, and fourth one is called anchored wall. Let us see one by one with its specifications. Gravity retaining wall. The gravity retaining walls are stabilized by their own mass, and these are constructed with dense or heavy materials such as concrete and sometimes an stone masonry, and are usually reinforced. Some gravity retaining walls use mortar, and in case of dry stone, sometimes it can be used with the help of dried stones. Second one is cantilever retaining wall. These cantilever retaining walls are made up of an internal stem or of steel reinforced, which may be cast in situ and mortar masonry, which is looks like an inverted T shape. And these cantilever walls will act like a beam to lodge a structural footing, converting horizontal pressure from behind the walls to vertical pressure on the ground below. And the third one is sheet piling retaining wall, in which sheets are used to retain this soil mass. Last one is board pile retaining wall, in which board piles are in a sequence are used, preceded by excavating away this excess soil. Similar type of retaining wall you can see it in the hilly areas, whereas this retaining wall will be anchored by means of cables. Out of all the types of retaining wall, the most common types of retaining wall used in construction or in practice is cantilever retaining wall and counterfort retaining wall. The cantilever retaining wall will have a shape of an inverted T, in which two portions, the vertical portion is called stem and the horizontal portion is called base slab, and the front portion is called toe slab, and the rear portion is called heel slab. The basic elements can be designed with this wall proportions, whereas the top width of the stem is usually taken as a minimum of 200 mm, and the bottom width of the stem is usually designed for the maximum bending moment due to horizontal earth pressure P. The maximum bending moment due to horizontal earth pressure will be given by this. The soil mass behind the stem will create a pressure that will be acting on the stem. Width of the slab is B. Width of the slab is P. The portion of the toe slab and the heel slab, including width of the bottom portion of the stem, is called width of this slab. And height of the retaining wall is usually taken as height. Height of the retaining wall is from topmost portion of the stem to the bottommost portion of the base slab. And height of the retaining wall is denoted by capital H. and width of the slab is usually 0.5 times the overall height of the retaining wall to 0.6 times overall height of the retaining wall without surcharge. Surcharge, and if it is with surcharge, it is 0.7 times the height of the retaining wall, overall height of the retaining wall. And the toe projection is 1/3 of B. The toe projection is 1/3 of B. Usually the thickness of the base slab is equal to the thickness of the stem. Thickness of the base slab. The thickness of the base slab is equal to the thickness of the stem. And the design principles for cantilever retaining wall are: first, stem slab, heel slab, toe slab, and stem. So the usually heel slab is designed for the maximum bending moment due to the earth pressure from bottom, maximum bending moment due to the earth pressure from the bottom, and weight of the earth and heel slab from the top. Weight of the earth and heel slab from the top. And toe slab is designed for the maximum bending moment due to the earth pressure from the bottom and weight on the toe slab from the top. Earth pressure from the bottom and weight of the earth on the toe slab. And after designing heel slab and toe slab, an horizontal check for horizontal sliding will be performed. This horizontal sliding will include all the vertical loads. Vertical loads such as self weight of the stem, weight of the earth pressure, and self weight of the base slab. And all these vertical loading W1, W2 will be checked for horizontal sliding with the equation mu W by P, which should be greater than the factor of safety 1.5. And mu is the coefficient of friction, P is the horizontal earth pressure created on the rear side, on the rear side of the stem. And this is how the design principle behind cantilever retaining wall. The second one is counterfort retaining wall. Cantilever retaining wall can be constructed if the height of the retaining wall is lesser than 5 meter, whereas if the height of the retaining wall increase to more than 5 meter, a counterfort will be given, a counterfort will be provided. And this portion behind the stem is called counterfort. So as discussed here, the retaining walls of the height more than 5 or 5.5 meter is usually provided with counterfort. The counterfort retaining wall consists of stem or upright slab, toe slab similar to cantilever retaining wall, heel slab, and counterfort are spaced at regular intervals. And the spacing of this counterfort is denoted by means of letter L. And this L has the minimum spacing of 3 to 3.5 meter, minimum of 3 meter to maximum of 3.5 meter, depending upon the entire length of the surcharge. The thickness of the slab is given by 2 times the spacing of the counterforts into overall height of the retaining wall from stem to base slab, bottom portion of the base slab, where L is the spacing of the counterfort and H is the overall height of the retaining wall in meter, and it is denoted and it is given in terms of centimeters. The thickness of the slab is given in terms of centimeters. And base width of the counterfort retaining wall is 0.6 to 0.7 times the height of the retaining wall. And the toe projection is 1/4 of the width of the base, whereas in cantilever retaining wall it is 1/3. So this will give you a clear idea about how the counterfort retaining wall will be looking like. So the stem or upright portion, toe slab, heel slab, counterfort, and length of the counterfort, spacing between the counterforts. The design principle behind a counterfort retaining wall are: the stem or upright slab is designed as continuous slab to span between the counterforts, to span between the counterforts, and the maximum bending moment is given as PL square by 12. PL square by 12, where P is the pressure intensity in kilonewton per meter cube, meter square, and L is the spacing between the counterfort. And this pressure intensity P is given by W into height of the stem, product of W into height of the stem into 1 minus sin phi divided by 1 plus sin phi, where W is the density of the soil. W is the density of the soil. The toe slab is designed for a soil pressure and dead weight of the slab. And heel slab is designed as a continuous slab supported between the counterfoot to resist the weight of the soil and upward pressure at the base. Toe slab is designed for the soil pressure and dead weight of the slab. Soil pressure and the dead weight of the slab. And heel slab is designed as a continuous slab. Heel slab is designed as a continuous slab supported between counterfort to resist the weight of the upward pressure created at the bottom surface of the base slab. Counterfort thickness is same as the base slab. Counterfort thickness is the thickness of the base slab. Counterfort thickness is the thickness of the counterfort is the thickness of the base slab. And counterforts are designed to take lateral earth pressure. The counterforts are designed to take up the earth lateral earth pressure created by this backfill. And a maximum bending moment in the counterfort is Cp into WH cube by 6 into spacing between the counterfort, where Cp is 1 minus sin phi by 1 plus sin phi. And W is the density of the soil, and H is the height of the stem. Let us discuss about a solved problem in the same textbook. So this is the given parameters for designing a cantilever retaining wall. Design a cantilever retaining wall to retain earth embankment 4 meter high above the ground level. The density of the earth is 18 kN per meter cube and its angle of repose is 30 degrees. The embankment is horizontal and at its top. The safe bearing capacity of the soil may be taken as 200 kN per meter square. And the coefficient of friction between the soil and concrete is 0.5. And adopt M20 grade of concrete and Fe4N5 high density steel bars. So based on the design parameters, the data is derived from the given set of design parameters. So height of the embankment above the ground level is 4 meter. Density of the soil, which is W, is 18 kN per meter cube. Angle of repose phi is 30 degrees. Safe bearing capacity of the soil P is 200 kN per meter square. Coefficient of friction is 0.5. Grade of concrete is M20. So FCK value is 20 N per mm square. And Fe415 density bar is used. So Fy is 415 N per mm square. So let us solve this problem. Let us discuss about solving this problem. So after deriving the design parameters, after deriving the data from the given parameters, the first and the foremost important step is the depth of the foundation. Dimension of the retaining wall, that includes depth of the foundation from the ground level, height of the stem, width of the stem, overall width of the base slab, and overall height of the retaining wall, thickness of the base slab, thickness of the stem at the base, height of the stem, and width of the base slab. So minimum depth of the foundation is given by the formula p by w into 1 minus sin phi the whole square divided by 1 plus sin phi. And whereas p is the safe bearing capacity of the soil, which is 200 kilonewton per meter square, and w is the density of the soil, 18 kilonewton per meter square, meter cube, 18 kilonewton per meter cube. And 1 minus sine 5 is 30 degrees, and 1 plus sine 5 30 degrees, which is shown here. And this results 1.2 meter, that is the minimum depth of the foundation should be 1.2 meter. So we are adopting the minimum depth of foundation as 1.2 meter. Since the height of the embankment is 4 meter high above the ground level, we need to identify, we need to calculate the overall height of the retaining wall. So overall height of the retaining wall is denoted by H, which is equal to height of the embankment above the ground level is 4 meter, and the depth of the foundation we have calculated it as 1.2 meter. So 4 plus 1.2 will give you the overall height of the retaining wall from topmost, from the top portion to the bottom portion. So we have determined the overall height of the retaining wall as height of the embankment, which is 4 meter above the ground level, plus minimum depth of the foundation as 1.2 meter. So 4 plus 1.2 meter will give you the overall height of the retaining wall, H. So overall height of the retaining wall is 1.2 meter, the depth of the foundation, plus height of the stem is 4.75. So 4.75 plus overall height is 1.2 plus 4. So 1.2 plus 4, so 5.2 meter. The overall height of the retaining wall is 1.2 plus 5. So the overall height is from the topmost of the stem portion to the bottom of the base slab, so 5.2 meter. So after determining the overall height, we need to calculate the thickness of the base slab, thickness of the stem at the base, and height of the stem. So overall, from the overall height h, the thickness of the base slab can be determined as follows: h by 12 in mm. So 5200 mm divided by 12, which is given as 433 mm, and we are taking or adopting the thickness of the base slab as 450 mm. So the thickness of the base slab is 450 mm using the form using h by 12, where h is 5200 mm divided by 12, which gives us the thickness of the base slab. Then after determining the thickness of the base slab, the thickness of the stem at the base shall be taken as equal to the thickness of the base slab, which is 450 mm. Then from the overall height of the retaining wall, height of the stem is determined, that is denoted by means of small h. So height of the stem is overall height, capital H, 5.2 meter divided by thickness of the base slab, 450 mm. So 5.2 meter minus 450 mm will give you 4.75. Height of the stem is 4.75. From the overall height of the retaining wall, the width of the base slab, includes from D to A, or this bottom portion, the whole bottom portion width is determined from the overall height of the retaining wall. So B is 0.5 times the height, overall height of the retaining wall, to 0.6 times the height of the retaining wall. So 0.5 times the height gives you 2.6 meter, and 0.6 times the height is 3.12 meter. So we are so minimum 2.6 to maximum 3.1, so we are adopting 3 meters. So the overall height of the overall width of the base slab is 0.5 times the height to 0.6 times, and we are taking that as 3 meter. So 3 meter. So after determining the dimension of the retaining wall, such as the dimension of the stem, height of the stem, width of the stem, thickness of the base slab, width of the base slab, we are going to determine or design the stem, or we are going to provide the reinforcement for the stem. So as we already know, the height of the stem is 4.75 meter, the maximum working moment of the stem. So the maximum working moment of the stem is created by this whole soil mass above the heel portion of the base slab and behind the stem portion, this soil mass. So the maximum working moment is given by the equation M is equal to Cp into W H cube by 12, where W is the safe bearing capacity of the soil and H is the height of the stem, and Cp is 1 minus sin phi by 1 plus sin phi, and phi is the angle of repose, 30 degrees, and W is the unit weight of the soil or density of the soil, 18 kilonewton per meter cube. By substituting the values of Cp, W and H, the maximum working moment in the stem is found to be 107.17 kilonewton meter. Since the reinforcement is designed for the factored bending moment, the maximum bending moment found has to be factored with a factor of safety 1.5. So 1.5 times the maximum working moment in the stem is 1.5 into 107.17, which is given as 161 kilonewton per meter, kilonewton meter. And we have to determine the limiting thickness of the stem at the base, which is determined as D. D is equal to factored bending moment, square root of factored bending moment divided by 0.138 FCK into B. And this B is for 1 meter length, and FCK is compressive strength of the concrete. MU is the factored bending moment, so which is given as 242 mm. So whatever the thickness of the stem is taken as 200 mm, this is more value. The value is lesser than the limiting thickness. And effective depth at the bottom portion of the stem is determined as 400 mm, which is tapering from the bottom portion. Right. So the top motion, the top thickness is 200 mm, but when it is gradually increased to the tapering side of tapering portion at the base of the stem is 450 mm, which is equal to the thickness of the base slab. So now the reinforcement has to be provided for the stem portion of the retaining wall. So with the calculated factored bending moment mu by BD square, we are going to provide the reinforcement for this particular portion of the retaining wall, which is called stem, the vertical portion. So mu by BD square for 1 meter length. 1 meter length is given as 1.006 based on the factored bending moment, effective depth of the stem, and for 1 meter length. So mu is 161, the factored bending moment, and we are converting that into Newton meter, and Newton mm. Newton mm. And B is for 1 meter length, 1000 mm into D, effective depth is 400, D square is 400 square. This is performed to find the percentage of reinforcement. This is done to find the percentage of reinforcement, which is found to be 1.00625. And after finding the percentage of reinforcement, refer table number 2 of SP16. The percentage of reinforcement for MU by BD square is 1, for Fe415 is 0.295, and area of steel is found to be percentage of steel into percentage of steel for 1 meter length into effective depth. So a percentage of steel is 0.3 into, so we are rounding based on the SP16 table 2. We have taken the area of steel as 0.3, so 0.3 into for 1 meter length B 1000 into effective depth D 400 mm. This is done to provide in order to find the area of the steel 1200 mm². So by referring table number 96 in SP16, for 1200 mm² area, we are providing 16 mm diameter bar at 150 mm center to center in a vertical direction at the bottom of the stem, and that area is in the SP is 134 mm². So whenever you design an RCC structure, the reinforcement provided will be more than the reinforcement required. Here the required reinforcement, area of reinforcement or area of steel is 1200 mm², but actual providing reinforcement is 1341 mm². And after finding the reinforcement, the distribution bar is usually 12 percentage. So 12% for 1 meter length into entire depth of the stem, which is 450 mm. So 12%, 0.12% of the distribution bar. The distribution bar is 0.12% of the cross section for 1 meter length. So 0.12 divided by 100 into 1 meter length 1000 mm into 450 mm. So that results 540 mm², and by referring SP16 table number 96, we are providing 10 mm diameter bar as 250 mm center to center. After providing the reinforcement for the stem, stability calculation, that is all the vertical load and the pressure created by the earth mass behind the stem portion need to be calculated. So heel projection is, we already found out the overall width of the base slab as 3 meter, and we need to determine the projection of toe slab from the overall width is 3 meter, and we need to find the heel projection. So heel projection is 2 minus the width of the slab, 450 mm, so that gives 1.55 meter. So the projection of the heel slab is 1.55 mm from base of the stem. So 1.55 mm. The stability calculation is performed in such a way that all self weight of the stem base slab is determined including the moment due to the earth pressure, where W1 is the self weight of the stem, W2 is the self weight of the base slab, W3 is the pressure weight of the soil mass, which includes the pressure created on the rear portion of the stem. So in order to determine the weight acting on the weight, in order to determine the weight of the entire structure, the self weight has to be determined. So W1 refers to the self weight of the stem. So self weight of the stem can be divided into two portions, one rectangular portion 200 mm by 200 mm rectangular portion, and the area of the triangular portion 250 mm from here. So the first portion, rectangular portion, is 200 mm into the height of the retaining wall is 4.75. So 0.2 into 4.75 into the unit weight of the concrete here is taken as 2500 kilonewton. So 0.2 into 4.75 into 25. Similarly, the second portion, the triangular portion of the stem from the top, is 1/3 into half into base is 0.250 into height is 4.75. So half into base is 0.25 into 4.75 into unit weight of the concrete is 25 kilonewton per meter square. And W2 is the weight of the base slab. Weight of the base slab, the dimension is 3 meter by 0.45 meter into the unit weight of the concrete, which is nothing but 25 kilonewton per meter square. So W2 is 3 into 0.45 meter into 25, and this gives the product for W1 is 23.80 kilonewton, and the triangular portion. So the total weight W1 is split into two. One, first the rectangular portion of the stem 200 by 200, and the second one is the triangular portion, half into base into height, half into 250 mm into height is 4.75, and third is W3 is the weight due to this soil mass or the backfill. So the dimension is 1.55 into 4.75 into the unit weight of the soil. Here the unit weight of the soil is given in the question as 18 kilonewton per meter cube. So 1.55 into 4.75 into unit weight of the soil 18, and the product is given as 132.51. All these loads are vertical, and the earth pressure created due to this soil mass will be acting on the rear portion of the stem as the earth pressure, which is horizontal earth pressure. So this horizontal earth pressure is given by the formula Cp, given by the equation Cp into WH cube by 6, where Cp is 1 minus sin phi, phi is the angle of repose, 1 minus sin phi by 1 plus sin phi, and W is the unit weight of the soil 18, and H cube is the height of the soil mass. Height of the soil mass 4.75 cube divided by 6, and this, since this create direct earth pressure, it will be added to the total moment. And the magnitude of the load is determined based on the loading calculation and with the use of unit weight of the concrete under soil. The distance from the base slab is given as this distance from A. In order to determine the moment created due to this self weight, so W1 into the distance from A is 1.55 into the center of this rectangular portion 0.22 divided by 2. Then for second portion, the triangular is 1.55 plus 0.22 into 1/3 of 0.25 meter or 250 mm. So the distance from A for W1 is 1.55 1.55 in 1.55 plus 0.2 divided by 2, which gives you 1.65. Similarly, the triangular portion of the stem is 1/3 of 0.250, 1/3 of 0.250. Which gives you the value 1.83. Plus 1.55, which give you 1.83. So the second triangular portion is given as the the length from A is 1.55 plus 0.2 plus 1/3 of 0.25, which is 1.83 meter from A. W2 is the self weight of this base slab, and the distance from A is 1.55 divided by 2. 1.55 divided by 2. Is this portion, but since we are calculating the entire weight of the slab, it is 3 by 2 1.5 meter, and W3 is the weight of the soil behind the stem, which is nothing but 1.55 divided by 2, 0.775 meter. 1.55 divided by 2 for W3. And the magnitude of the load has to be summed up, W1 plus W2 plus W3, which gives you 204.90, and the moment is W1 plus W2 by W, the moment created due to the self weight of the stem, base and soil pressure, and the pressure created due to this earth mass, which is nothing but 327.45. The purpose of calculating the stability for 1 meter run of the wall is to determine the eccentricity E. Eccentricity E is given by the equation summation moment of summation moment, the moment created by stem, base, earth pressure, divided by the load due to this three and the load due to this three components, stem, base and the soil pressure, and the value of the eccentricity is, to calculate the eccentricity we need to find the value of z, that is the lever arm distance. So eccentricity E is equal to z minus b by 2, where b is the width of the stem, width of the base slab, which is equal to 3 meters. So the total product of the moment divided by the total weight of the retaining wall gives you 1.6 meter, and eccentricity is calculated as E is equal to z minus b by 2. That is resulting as 0.1 meter, and b by 6 is 3.6, 3 by divided by 6, which is equal to 0.5, and eccentricity is lesser than b by 6. So the maximum and the minimum pressure can be calculated by using the value of the eccentricity. In order to find the location of the maximum and the minimum pressure below the base slab, the maximum and the minimum pressure is determined by the equation summation W1 plus W2 by W1 plus W2 by W3 divided by 3, into 1 plus 6e by b, where b is the 6e by b, w, summation w 204.9 kilonewton divided by 3 into 1 plus 6 into 0.1 divided by 3, where 3 is the width, that the width of the base lab, plus or minus. So 1 plus or minus 6e by b, and from this maximum and the minimum pressure is found to be 55 kilonewton per meter square. The minimum pressure and the maximum pressure is 82 kilonewton per meter square. As you can see, the maximum pressure is acting in the front portion of the tow slab, and the minimum pressure is acting on the tip of the heel slab at A. This is due to the major earth pressure and the self weight of the retaining wall. And after determining the stability for 1 meter run of the wall, the second portion is to determine the design of the heel slab. Now, after providing the reinforcement, after designing the reinforcement for the stem, we are going to design the reinforcement for this heel portion of the retaining wall. So the heel portion of the retaining wall is determined as the weight, self weight of the heel slab, and the pressure which is created below the bottom portion of the heel slab. We have to detect the self weight and the upward pressure created by the soil below the base slab. So in order to determine the moment of the heel slab, the weight acting on the heel slab is determined as the weight acting on the heel slab, which is nothing but the earth pressure, 1.55 into 4.75 into density of the unit weight of the soil, or density of the soil is 18, and the self weight of the heel slab, which is nothing but 1.55 into 0.45 into unit weight of the concrete, 25 kilonewton per meter square. And these two has to be subtracted with the upward pressure created below the heel portion of the retaining wall. Since the minimum pressure is found to be 55 kilonewton per meter square, we need to find the portion acting on this portion, the pressure acting on this portion of the heel slab. So the upward pressure A B J H plus H J G has to be deducted with the self weight of the heel slab as well as the weight of the earth pressure. So this portion, this pressure is determined by using a simple mathematical equation. For 0 at A it is 55. So let me show you that calculation here. So the minimum pressure intensity is 55, and the maximum pressure intensity is 82 kilonewton per meter square. So this portion of the heel slab, the pressure intensity need to be found out, need to be calculated. And this pressure intensity is given by, at here the pressure intensity is 55, and we need to determine here, right? So the distance is 1.55. So at 0 it is 55, at 1.55 it is taken as x, at 3 it is 82. So 82 minus 55 divided by 3 minus 0, 82 minus 55 divided by 3 minus 0 into 1.55 minus 0 will give you the entire pressure intensity at BG, and this has to be related with 55. That gives you 13.95. So after determining the pressure intensity at the base slab, the heel portion of the base slab, so detect the upward pressure. This is founded as 13.9 kilonewton per meter square. So to determine the maximum working bending moment at the base heel portion of the base slab, self weight of the earth and self weight of the heel portion of the base slab has to be detected with this upward pressure intensity. So upward pressure intensity for this rectangular and triangular portion is found at as found as is found 53.84 into 53.84 this portion 55.55 into 1.55 and half into base is 1.55 into height is 13.9, which gives you 83 and 110. Here it is not 53.84, it is 55, this pressure intensity, the minimum pressure intensity into the distance. And the distance from A is 1.55 divided by 2 for W3, and for self weight of the E slab is 1.55 divided by 2, and similarly for the upward pressure A, B, G, H is 1.55 divided by 2, and for G, H, J, the upward pressure is 1 by 3 of 1.55 since it's a triangular portion. So the product of magnitude of the load and the distance from A is given as the moment, and total moment has to be found out by deducting the self weight and the upward soil pressure. So the maximum working bending moment in the heel slab is found to be 46 kilonewton meter, and the reinforcement will be provided. The reinforcement will be provided for the factored bending moment by taking factor of safety as 1.5 into the maximum working bending moment 46. So 1.5 times the working moment 46 is 69 kilonewton meter, and for finding the percentage of steel or finding the percentage of the steel, refer SP16 table number 2 for finding the percentage of reinforcement. So mu by BD square, mu is the factored bending moment or the ultimate moment mu divided by for 1 meter length 1000 mm into the effective depth 400 square, which gives you 0.43, and by referring SP16 the percentage of steel reinforcement is found to be 0.12, and 0.12 into B is the 1000 mm into effective depth 400 divided by 100 will give you 484 mm square. And in order to provide reinforcement of 484 mm square, provide 12 mm dia bars at 200 mm center to center for the area 565, and for the distribution reinforcement, which is 0.12% for the cross section, is given as 540. So we are providing 12 mm bars at 200 mm center to center for the distribution bar. So after determining or designing the reinforcement for stem heel slab, now reinforcement has to be designed for toe slab. For determining the reinforcement for toe slab, similar procedure has to be followed by calculating the self weight and upward pressure, thereby deducting the upward pressure from the self weight. We will get the maximum service bending moment, the maximum working bending moment on the toe slab. Here the toe slab has soil above the toe slab, which is 1.2 meter from the base of the base slab. So the maximum working moment will be determined by deducting the upward pressure, deducting the upward pressure as well as upward pressure below the toe portion, as well as self weight of the toe slab and self weight of the soil above the toe slab. So the upward pressure below the toe slab is given by the same, can be determined by the same. At A, the minimum pressure intensity is 55 kN meter. At C, which is 2 meter from A, is need to be found out. So for 0, it is 55. At 2, the pressure intensity has to be found out. So I'm keeping it as X. At 3, it is 82. So 82 minus 55 into 82 minus 55 divided by 3 minus 0 into 2 will give you 71.78. So the upward pressure intensity for the portion CDIF, rectangular plus triangular portion IEF, half into base into height. So by deducting 82 minus 71 will give you the pressure intensity for IE. So the upward pressure is upward pressure for the toe slab CDIF. CDIF is 71.78 into the length. Length is 1 meter. The length is 1 meter. Then the triangular portion, half into base is 1 into height is 8.98 kN. Pressure intensity for that triangular portion is 8.98. This gives you the magnitude of the load as 71.4 kN. The distance from D is 1/2, which is 0.5, and the distance for the triangular portion is 2/3 of 1, which is 0.67, and the moment from C is, the moment from C is 35.89 and 3, total moment. The total moment has to be deducted by the moment created due to the self weight of the toe slab, as well as the dead weight of the soil above the toe slab. Self weight of the toe slab and dead weight of the soil above the toe slab. So 1 into 0.45 into self weight of the toe slab is the unit weight of the concrete, and dead weight of the soil can be found out by using the unit weight of the soil, 0.75 into 1 into 18. 0.75 is by deducting 1.2 minus 0.450. So the length of the height of the soil above the toe slab is 0.75. 0.75 into 1 into unit weight of the soil is 18, and the distance from A is 1/2 from C. The moment about C is 5. By deducting the moment created due to the upward pressure, the triangular and the rectangular portion, and the moment created due to the self weight of the toe slab and the dead weight of the soil above the toe slab will get maximum service bending moment in the toe slab as 26.54. And the factored bending moment, factored or bending moment or the ultimate moment in the toe slab is found to be multiplying by 1.5 times the maximum service bending moment, which is 39.81 kilonewton meter. And in order to find the percentage of steel reinforcement, mu by bd square for toe slab is given here, where mu is the ultimate moment created in the toe slab, 26.54 kilonewton meter, and we are converting that to newton meter, newton mm. So 39.81 into 10 to the power of 6 divided by for 1 meter length 1000 into effective depth 400 mm. The percentage of reinforcement is computed as 0.244 by referring table 2 of SP16. The reinforcement, the area of the steel reinforcement is found out as 540 mm square. Area of reinforcement is found out to be 0.244, and since the minimum reinforcement is 0.12% of the total cross sectional area, 540 mm square is provided by providing 12 mm diameters at 200 mm center to center for the area of the steel, 565 mm square by from SP16. So after providing the reinforcement for stem, heel slab and toe slab, check for safety against sliding. This check for safety against sliding and all this will be given in a separate video, but for designing the retaining wall, theoretically the total horizontal earth pressure, check for sliding is done by using this equation, P is equal to Ka into W into H square by 2, where H is the overall height of the retaining wall and W is the density of the soil, 18 kilonewton per meter cube. Overall height is 5.22. Ka is 1 minus sin 5 by 1 plus sin 1 plus sin 5 by 1 minus sin 5. That is 81.12 kilonewton. And assuming the coefficient of friction mu as 0.5, the maximum possible frictional force W is calculated as mu into the total vertical load 204. So mu into 204 kilonewton, which gives 102.4 kilonewton. So factor of safety against sliding is the maximum possible frictional force W divided by the horizontal earth pressure P, 81.12, which is 1.26. that is lesser than the factor of safety 1.5. So if check for sliding is lesser than 1.26, the shear key has to be provided. Shear key is nothing but the extension of base of the stem below the base of the base slab. So shear key is designed if the maximum possible frictional force, and horizontal earth pressure is lesser than factor of safety 1.5. So the design of the key, shear key is designed by using this equation, Pp is equal to Kp into P, where Kp is 1 plus sin 5 by 1 minus sin 5, and P is the pressure A PP is intensity of the passive pressure developed in front of the shear key. Value of PP is 82 minus half into base into the unit weight of the soil, which is nothing but 73 kilonewton per meter cube, which is nothing but this value. So the pressure intensity P just in front of the shear key is 82 minus half into one base into unit weight of the soil 18, which is nothing but 73. So PP is 3 into 72.8, where 3 is the base with thickness of the base, width of the base, 3 into 72.8 to 18.6 kilonewton per meter square. And if A is the depth of the shear key, the depth of the shear key is the width of the stem. So in order to check the designed shear key, the reinforcement, the total passive pressure, if A is the depth of the shear key 450 mm, usually the depth of the shear key is taken as the width of the bottom portion of the stem, which is nothing but this thickness. So the shear key will be extended below the bottom portion of the stem. So in order to check the designed shear key against sliding, so FS, factor of safety against sliding for the designed shear key, is given by W plus PP, passive earth pressure, divided by the pressure pressure intensity P, 82. So 102, the total load, plus 98.3, the total passive pressure, divided by the pressure 81.12, which is equal to 2.45, that is greater than 1.5, the factor of safety 1.5. Hence the designed shear key is stable against sliding. So after designing the shear key and checking it for sliding, check for shear stress at the junction of the stem at the base. Junction of the stem at the base portion is this portion against shear force. Shear force on against the shear stress. So to check the shear force, we need to find the net shear force acting on that particular structure. So that is given by V is equal to 1.5 P, the pressure, and M into W, where M is the moment created at the horizontal earth pressure, horizontal earth pressure 81.12. So the net shear force V is 1.5 P minus M into W, the total load 102. So 1.5 into 81.2, the pressure, active earth pressure, minus the total load 102.4. So that is 19.28 kilonewton, the shear force. The factored shear force is 1.5 times the net work, the net shear force, 19.28, which is 28.92. The nominal shear stress is given by tau V, which is equal to V U divided by the effective depth in into 1 meter length. So 28.92, converting that to Newton into 10 to the power of 3 divided by 1000 into 400, which is 0.0. 1072 newton per mm square. To check the permissible limit, to check the shear stress for a permissible limit, it has to be provided with a reinforcement 100 AST by BD. So 100 into AST is 1341, which is shown by the table 19 from IS 456. So after finding the nominal shear stress, it has to be checked for the permissible shear stress from table 19 IS 456 2000. By checking the value of tau c, which is 0.40 for Fe415, which is greater than tau v, 0.072 newton per mm square, and the shear reinforcement is given by using the formula 100 AST by BD square as this. And this is the reinforcement detail for the cantilever retaining wall. Thank you for watching this explanation based on the solved problems.